In this video, we continue to talk about feedback, covering the feedback stability and feedback compensation topic. In the previous video, of which I leave the link in the description, we talked about the advantages of using the feedback in amplifiers, such as gain sensitivity, bandwidth enlargement, improving nonlinearity, and control of input-output impedances. Here, we see the stability issue because if you don't pay attention to the feedback, you could create instability. Let's see the general working of the feedback. Basically, the feedback put back to the input a portion of the output signal and we subtract this portion from the input signal XS, getting the signal XI, which we amplify to get the output signal. So, the larger the output signal, the larger XF, the portion of signal we subtract from the input, thus lowering the signal to be amplified, so in the end there is a trade-off, and the output signal converges to a stable result. However, looking to this formula, we see that if AOL times beta is equal to minus 1, the closed loop gain tends to infinity, or in other words, our system becomes unstable. In order to understand why the feedback can introduce instability, we have to talk about the phase of the signal and take into account the frequency behavior. Let's see this example once again. The input signal XS is amplified by the amplification stage AOL and we get the amplified output XO. If we add a feedback, we see that the output is subtracted from the input XS and now the amplified signal is XI less than XS. So the output is now this, which is of course less than the output without feedback. If we now assume that the open loop stage AOL is an inverting stage so that it introduces a phase shift of 180 degrees, we have that the output becomes this, and this is XF, the portion to be subtracted from the input. So now we have to subtract a negative value, so the feedback signal is added to the input and the feedback is now positive. So the signal to be amplified is now larger than before and it becomes larger and larger and the system becomes unstable because we keep adding the output to the input. For this reason, the phase of the signals is very important for assessing feedback stability. Another important issue is the frequency behavior of the amplifier because the gain and the phase of amplifiers change as the frequency changes. Here we see the boat plot of an operational amplifier with three poles. The first pole defines the bandwidth of the amplifier, so the frequencies in which the gain remains stable. After the first pole, the gain decreases of 20 dB per decade. The phase at the first pole is 45 degrees going towards 90 degrees. At the second pole, the phase shift is 135 degrees going towards 180 degrees, and the gain decreases of 40 dB per decade. At the third pole, the phase shift is 225 degrees going towards 270. So in this case, you see there are frequencies in which the phase shift is 180 degrees. So the signal in that frequency is added to the input rather than subtracted, producing instability. Even if the frequency of our working signal is within the first pole, we could have noise at the frequency with 180 degrees of phase shift, so that the noise component at that frequency is subjected to a positive feedback, increasing quickly till the saturation. This is what happens when a microphone is held too closely to the speaker of a public address system. More than likely, most people have heard the loud ringing that occurs. The positive feedback causes the system to become unstable, and the undesired effect is clearly recognizable. So, an amplifier with this boat plot is stable, but if we apply a feedback on this amplifier, we get instability. We call FG the frequency on which the gain is 1 or 0 dB, and FP the frequency on which the phase shift is 180 degrees. So, if we have FP less than FG, we have instability because all the signal at FP frequency corresponding to 180 phase shift is magnified, fed back, and added to the input, creating divergence. So, ultimately, the instability is created because at the FP frequency the gain is high. If the gain is high at that frequency, we keep adding to the input an amplified output signal, thus producing a divergent signal on the output. Here we see the case Fp is greater than Fg, so the frequency in which we have the phase shift at 180 degrees is greater than the frequency in which we have the gain at 1 or 0 dB. In this case, if we add a feedback to this amplifier, the signal or the noise at Fp frequency is not magnified but attenuated, although fed back to the input. So in this case, we add to the input a signal gradually smaller and the output converges to a stable level. The more attenuated the signal, the less ringing the output will have. Here we see two important specifications, the phase margin and the gain margin. Gain margin is defined as the difference between the magnitude of the gain loop at 180 degrees and unity, whereas phase margin is defined as the difference between the value of the phase at the frequency in which the magnitude of the gain loop is equal to unity and 180 degrees. The higher the gain margin, the more attenuated is the signal at the phase frequency and the less ringing the output will have. However, it should be noted that the phase margin is the typical specification used for stability. Amplifiers should be designed to have a phase margin of at least 45 degrees, though 60 degrees phase margin is more acceptable. But why we need a phase margin? It would not be enough for the phase frequency to be larger than the gain frequency? The answer to this question involves the realization that a large load capacitance can increase the phase shift through the amplifier and the feedback network normally does not have zero propagation delay. Imagine to use a CMOS technology and consider using an N-well resistor in the feedback loop. The delay through the N-well resistor translating into a phase shift at a given frequency is given by this formula. So we need the 60 degrees phase margin to be sure that the extra phase shift coming from the capacitive load and the feedback line don't take the total shift to 180 degrees. So what can you do if you have a normal amplificator with three poles as you see in this plot? We know that if we add a feedback, the circuit becomes unstable. So for reaching the stability, we must do something to compensate the situation. For example, we can lower the loop gain in this way, in which you see the phase shift Fp is greater than the gain frequency Fg, thus attenuating the signal at phase frequency, the frequency in which we have a phase shift of 180 degrees. In this way, the circuit becomes stable, but we lose gain. A better way to stabilize the circuit is introducing a compensation capacitor in the amplifier, thus shifting the first pole back in this way. At the phase frequency, the signal is attenuated, so the circuit is stable. This technique is called feedback compensation and allows us to lower the frequency at the first pole in order to make the gain frequency enough lower than the phase frequency. In this way, we don't lose gain and we have a good phase margin, making the circuit stable, but of course we lose in bandwidth because we lower the first pole frequency. Let's see this example to better understand the feedback compensation. Here you see two amplification stages. This is the first amplifier in a cascode configuration. This is the current source. This is the second amplifier stage in a common source configuration. And this is another current source acting also as active load. Let's see the total gain. The cascode configuration has this gain, and the common source this other gain, so the total gain is approximately this. The poles of the amplifiers are created by the intrinsic capacitance and the resistances of the MOSFETs. But the dominant pole or the first pole is created by the resistances and capacitances between the two stages, where the Miller effect amplifies the capacitances. So the idea for shifting the first pole back, thus lowering the frequency of the first pole, is introducing a capacitance between the two amplificator stages. We don't need this capacitance to be too large because we exploit the Miller effect even for the compensation. We choose this capacitance in a way that allows us to have enough phase margin, as we said, 45 or better 60 degrees. We don't lose gain, but we lose bandwidth, making lower the frequency of the dominant pole. Please leave me a comment, let me know if you liked this video. Make sure you put a thumb up, click the notification bell, and subscribe to my channel.